going on, Flow Combaters? It's your man, Duane Finley, and I'm here with the king of Arizona. look at this monster. Like I told you, didn't I, Hunter? Like, this guy is just, you gotta see him in person. Like, Bader's a monster of a human being. What's up, Ryan?
Hey, what's going on, buddy?
Not much, man. And you know what's great is that every time I do one of these road trips, I come through here and you always open the doors to your house.
Absolutely.
So, you know, this is like a tradition.
Sure, buddy. I love it. I'm talking to you.
I love it too, man. And it's good that I catch you now because you got big stuff going on, man. You got you've been all over the headlines here lately.
Yeah, we're in a it's a good situation to be in, but I'm a free agent. You know, before my last fight, I decided, you know, I got a UFC contract. I decided to fight it out. Fought a little knockdown in Brazil. Ended up getting a TKO, and was able to kind of, you know, see my worth outside of the UFC, and so I got an offer from Bellator. Right now, I've had a lot of questions like, where are we right now? Right now, we're in the phase where UFC has it and they have a right to match, and so we're kind of sitting on our hands right now, kind of waiting.
Now that, if I'm not mistaken, that period only lasts for a certain amount of time, right?
Yeah, I believe it's only 14 days. And so there was a little issue in kind of contract legal issue that we're kind of working around and whatnot, and so, I believe kind of the 14 days started either yesterday or today.
So this thing's going to be resolved one way or another here in the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, hopefully in a couple weeks. You know, I came out and saw through the media, saw that Dana White said he was going to match it and whatnot. You know, so, you know, I took that for what it was worth. You know, I know it's in the media and whatnot, but so for me, it's looking like 90% you're going to Bellator, but mm-hmm. UFC still has it and still has the right to match, and who knows, could potentially match it. So, I mean, that's where we're at. I can't sit here and say I'm a Bellator fighter or I'm a UFC fighter, because I do not 100% know.
Well, the best thing about it for me, as your friend and a guy who's covered you for a long time, what I love about this is you're doing what's best for you. You have a beautiful family. You have you know, children, a future, and this fighting sport is it's very unforgiving, mm-hmm. and it's hard to come out on the other side with any type of security. I like the move that you're making because it's all about you. It's not being selfish, it's being smart.
Yeah. Well, I mean, five years ago, this wouldn't have happened, you know, and nobody fought their contracts out. A few people did, you know, like Gilbert Melendez did, a few people, but now you're gonna see a lot more people doing it. There's options outside of the UFC, you know, and, you know, I came up in the UFC. I had five fights, local fights, and I went in the Ultimate Fighter. I had 20 fights in the UFC, you know, so, you know, I love the UFC and I had a great time, but at this point, I got to look out what's best for me. And I had the opportunity to be a free agent, you know, and my last eight fights, I was 7-1. I'm ranked number 4 or 5, you know, and so it's in any other sport, this is what you covet as an athlete, is to get to the opportunity to see what you're worth outside in the market, you know. So it's a great opportunity for us. We took advantage of it, and now here we are, and whatever happens and whatever we decide is that's where we're going full force. You know, we're not looking back. We're moving forward, and I feel like I'm the best fighter I've ever been, and I'm going to continue in whatever organization to keep trying to go get that belt. You know, and I'm the best fighter I've ever been right now. So,
but could you imagine? You touched on something crucially important. Could you imagine any other sport? Could you imagine a quarterback coming off a great year, going into a contract year? Like you said, they covet that because mm-hmm. their value goes up. Could you imagine, like, say, Kirk Cousins having a great year at the Redskins and then fearing to go and visit other teams or talk to other teams because of repercussions that would, like, the Redskins take out on him, you know? That's the reality of this fight game.
Yeah.
That, like you said, 4 or 5 years ago, this wouldn't happen because if you went and you entertained talks with other organizations, then it's going to be, then you're
blackballed.
It's going to be bad news. You know, they'll either sit you out or you'll get you'll get terrible fights that you're not going to take because they're unranked or below you. So then you don't take them, and then the contract extends.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is the shit that this is the shit people don't know. This happens.
Oh, yeah.
This has happened a lot, you know? So I'm glad to see that you made that move, and I know this is going to work out for the best. And let's just say hypothetically that Bellator is where you end up.
Yeah.
We, on this road trip, we spent some time with the current Bellator light heavyweight champion, Mr. Phil Davis, and you're the last man to beat him. Mm-hmm. So he thinks it's a done deal.
Yeah.
In his head. He's like, he was happy to welcome you here. He said, I'm glad that, you know, Ryan's coming to Bellator. But then he said, on the business side, I want to fight.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts about stepping in, if you do step into Bellator, and then you fight for that title right away?
Yeah, that's a fight I want. You know, I'm not one of these guys like that's going over at the tail end of his career, you know, trying to make a couple extra paychecks and be done and trying to look for, you know, fun, easy fights. I'm looking to win the belt. And so on our side, we want to go in right away. And I think we can step in without people saying, oh, you're jumping too many people, mm-hmm. this and that, you know, where, you know, I'm ranked number 4 in the UFC, 7-1 my last 8 fights, you know, and it's one of those things where I can jump in and fight for the title right away, and I don't think there'd be too many people complaining about it. So that's the fight we want. We want to fight Phil Davis, you know, for the Bellator belt.
And I think that's what makes it so interesting, Ryan, is because, you know, when you hit the free agent market, you know, that's the thing, is that you're the most high profile guy to do this. I mean, make no mistake about it. Wherever you go, you're in title contention. You know, if you stay in the UFC by chance, you're right there. You're mm-hmm. a fight away, which for a title shot you should have got 2 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you go to Bellator, then you're stepping in for that title fight. So that makes you a very, you know, coveted individual. And for a guy who works as hard as you, how happy are you to see that you have these options?
Oh, it's great. And, you know, it wasn't about fighting my contract out and everything. I wasn't looking there and saying, all right, this is not enough money, I'm gonna move on. It was more than that. It was, you know, I talked about this before too, but it was opportunity and what's the plan for me. You mm-hmm. know, in this sport, you gotta look at it selfishly. You know, I gotta, all right. So with Bellator, I sat down with Scott and Rich. You know, I asked some questions, like, where's Bellator going, basically? What's your plan for me, you know, fight-wise and whatnot? And they had a plan, and you know, for
how,
me.
How nice did that
yeah,
feel?
Yeah, that's great, you know. That was a big thing, too. Obviously, you know, I like moving into more of a flat fee, too, for a fight, mm-hmm. which I think is great. I see the rationale behind doing a, you know, a show and win bonus, you know, maybe make the fighters a little more, just, you know, go out and obviously secure that win bonus, but I think it deters it a lot of times with different fights. You know, guys will go out there and make sure they win, you know, a certain way.
It's half your paycheck.
Or it's half your paycheck, you know, so I like that whole flat fee. You go out there and let loose and really not have to worry about it. Yeah, you want to win, but it's not the end of the world, you know. If you have a great fight and mm-hmm. people loved it, and you still get your full paycheck. That, the plan, and, you know, sponsorship's a big thing for me,
yep.
too.
Yeah, and I'm glad you said that, because that's something I definitely wanted to touch on. Now, I think it was our mutual friend Damon Martin mm-hmm. that you did an interview with recently, talking about how much in sponsorship money that you lost with Reebok. And for those who may not follow that side of it closely, you have more than anybody else. You have a list of blue chip sponsors that have been providing you a good amount of money. You have top-notch sponsorships that all of a sudden you couldn't utilize mm-hmm. when you were with under the Reebok deal.
Yeah, and luckily, you know, some of them have stuck by me. Obviously, they tweaked their sponsorship model. You know, American Ethanol has always been there for me, and Cytosport, who is mm-hmm. Monster Milk and Muscle Milk and all that. They've stuck around and been great, you know. But yeah, I mean, I put this out there before, and not to sit there and say, hey, look at numbers, whatever. But you know, I was on the prelims. And in the UFC, I was making 35 grand in sponsorships. You know, I made up to 80.
Yeah.
You know, now I'm making, I moved on to the next echelon because
the tier of
Reebok. But I was making, my last fight, I made 15,000, you know, just flat for the Reebok thing. And so that hurt us pretty big, too. And not only the financial side, but these guys have stuck through forever. And they're mm-hmm. still sticking by me and some other guys. And to be able to, you know, to bring them back on in the kind of the full scale sponsorship
yep.
model is huge, you know. And we had a lot of people, you know, you see a lot of fighters and whatnot, and not to shit on them, but say, oh, the sponsorship is dried up, you know, I'm glad I'm getting my 2500 from Reebok or whatever.
Not you.
And that's just, I feel like it's that's their manager's fault.
Yep.
Because they're doing the whole model of calling, you know, whoever was on, they're seeing whoever's on their shorts, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah, I like if there's a, I joke about it all the time, if there was a new patch on somebody's shorts, then you get 30 calls to guy, right?
Or American Ethanol, when they started sponsoring, myself and a few guys, they were getting murdered on the phone with people calling and, you know, and saying, hey, we got this guy coming up, you know? So that's what the MMA managers are doing, you know, and trying to secure sponsorship. And, you know, that you got to build a relationship with these sponsors,
yep.
you know, and you got to be valuable to them outside of wearing a patch on your short for one fight and then jump into the next one, whoever pay you $1,000 more,
yep.
you know? And so that's where, and then you hear about, that kind of dried up a little bit, and you hear people complain about it, and like, well, I'm just lucky I don't have to go out there and get my own sponsors, and I got this $2,500 Reebok sponsorship, you know, which blows my mind, you know, and so that's huge for us too, and that was one of the big factors and really to kind of fight the contract out and potentially leave is that sponsorship, what I was losing out on money-wise, financially-wise, and then also to be able to represent those guys that stuck by me the past, I mean, 5 to 8 years.
Yep. And, you know, I know he's modest, but I want to touch on something that, you know, you said MMA managers. You're fortunate enough to not have an MMA manager. Dave Martin is across several sports. He's a great businessman. I know he's modest. You don't like talking about it. So there's my plug.
Shout out to Dave.
So there you go, little guy. I can say that. He's smaller than me. That's crazy. But yeah, Dave's done a great job. And I've been fortunate enough to meet the representatives from some of the companies that represent you. And they really do care for you as a person. Because you, like you said, you don't just wear a shirt or a patch. You go out, you do these fundraisers. You are active in their endeavors, their philanthropy, in addition to your own. I mean, so if you're a company representing not just a fighter, but somebody who like hired for heroes, hired heroes, you go out and you've given a lot of time and effort and money to those groups. So if I'm a company and I say, hey man, Ryan Bader's one of our sponsees, then that makes you proud as a company, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, and it's the same, it's reciprocating, you know, we want to align ourselves with those people that we build relationships and those great people that would do stuff like, you know, say we're giving some money to hire heroes and say, hey, you wanna donate also, and they do it out of, you know, of support. And so, you know, those sponsors have been, invaluable, really, you know, and we, when that whole, you know, Reebok thing came, when we can't represent them in the octagon, you know, we found a different model and to make us valuable to them, you know, social media wise and doing different stuff for them and different content. And so we just tweaked it, but obviously it was a big hit. You know, they're not gonna, you know, it has to make financial sense to them also.
Yep.
So they've stuck by us, but I'm just, you know, if this moves forward, I'm excited to really represent them, you know, to the fullest. You know.
Yeah, and then if this does move forward, then that's got to be a great feeling to be like, all right, guys, you know, now I can represent you the way I want to represent you. Let me ask you this, and this is, you know, this isn't shitting on UFC or Reebok, but I've said this for a long time. I said, you know, in 10 years, we'll be able to look at a timeline and we'll be able to take a finger and go, that's when it all changed.
Yeah.
And I feel like the Reebok deal is when it all changed. Because fighters will take a lot. You can do a lot with fighters. You can knock them around. Once you start taking their money,
because
that's what that's what you guys bleed for in there, then it's a whole different dynamic, right?
Yeah. You know, and I was fortunate enough. I've had 20 fights in UFC, and I make a good purse, you know. But you know, these other guys that are coming in that have even, you know, 5 to 8 fights that really aren't making much, where, you know, and they're in a situation where they're paying their gym and they're paying their manager a ridiculous percentage that they don't need to, you know, and especially now in the atmosphere of the UFC, where you're not going out there securing sponsorships, you know, you're taking a phone call, you know, and so those guys, I mean, it's almost, you're just doing it for the love of the sport, because you're not doing it for the money, you know, so I do think that at that point that the Reebok deal was, you know, one of those catalysts for a lot of guys to not necessarily leave then, but leave now that there's opportunity.
Yep.
And You know, it's a big thing. You might say, all right, I have a decent purse, whatever, but I make it up in sponsorships. And that's fine. And I can control that. You know, I can go out there and hustle as hard as I want with my management team to secure as many sponsors as I can. And then that's on me. You know, and if I get a ton of money, great. And if I don't work at it, I'm not going to get any money.
Yeah.
So it is what it is. But, you know, I like the ability to be able to, you know, look at yourself and do it yourself.
Yeah.
So, I think that is a turning point. You know, it was for me, for sure.
Well, I'll tell you this, and it's so nice to see, man. Like, I see you, you know, we're in the same circle, like traveling nomads.
Yep.
And sitting here and talking to you, man, like, you're loose and happy, and, you know, and I can't say that's always been the case. I mean, you're always in a good mood.
Yeah.
Because you're a good guy, but you seem like, I don't know, man, you seem happy.
Yeah, I mean, it's refreshing. However this ends up, you know, we'll get what we want, basically, you know, and so... that's with Bellator, we got a great contract, and if UFC decides to pass, then great. We got a great contract. I like what Bellator is doing. They have a great 205 pound division. It's getting better. There's a lot of up and coming guys that were in the UFC that weren't re-signed that potentially could fill out that 205 pound division. You know, I like the structure of the payment, ability to wear sponsors, you know, and then on the other flip of the coin, if UFC matches, you know, I'm in the number one organization in the world, and I'm making great money, and, you know, we got what we wanted there, you know, so it's just, I'm in a good spot, it's refreshing, I feel good, I feel like I'm the best fighter, I'm healthy. I'm 33 years old, but I feel like I'm the best shape and best place mentally in my life, you know. Family life is good. I have a couple other businesses doing well, and so I'm branching out, and just life is good right now.
And I love to hear it. So I'll tell you what, you were kind enough to talk about the fight stuff, which I know, you know, could be stressful, but you handled it well. And I know there's a lot of people that wanted an update from you, so that's awesome. So let's talk about some fun stuff
for a while.
Okay, so, you know, we're on this road trip here, and I know you're a guy who likes to get out of town whenever you get a chance to. What are a few road trip essentials? Let's say like a guy's trip, like, you know, not, you know, with your family, you got the squeezy bottles and the rattly toys.
Yeah.
Let's say the wife's like, you know what, Ryan, you go with the boys for the weekend. Well, what's some essentials you gotta take?
Well, I called my drug dealer. I'm just kidding.
Hey, you're a belter now.
I just say whatever I want. No, I think it's just all about the people you have with it.
Yeah.
You know? And then I like to go to different places. You know, I get bored easily, and I need variety. So, you know, anything from, I love the beach. Anywhere there's a beach, I love the beach. We go to Newport a lot. You know, haven't been going to Vegas very much, but I also like doing outdoor stuff, you know, and doing a trip like that would be great. But it depends on what you're doing. But it's really just the people. As I've gotten older, I used to pack a ton of shit, but now I pack you know, a couple of days worth of clothes, and I get through that because we're having fun and don't have to worry about anything too much. So that's how I kind of like to roll on road trips.
See, now it's not that you're older; it's that you're married. Because now you're like, okay, before you said I have, like, you know, you got a couple, eight different, what am I going to wear?
Yeah,
you got
exactly.
The hair products. Now you're like, I got sweatpants. I might not even wear pants, you know what I'm
exactly.
saying?
And then it's to the point where when you're younger, you're like, all right, what are we doing tonight after you've been going all day? And now,
older,
I'm like,
oh man.
Nothing, I'm done. I'm a day drinker, done, and all right.
Oh dude, and you couldn't be in a more perfect place, and I know you know this, so I preach to everybody, because now when you hit your 30s, you know, day drinking is a thing that you find, and you're like, okay, this is great. There's no better place I've ever found in the entire country that celebrates day drinking like Scottsdale.
Scottsdale's pretty good.
That's a day drinking capital right there.
So we, a couple weekends ago, they had the Waste Management Open, the golf tournament. That's basically the biggest party.
Yeah, yeah, so that's the wild
people.
One, right?
Yeah. And so that's what we did last weekend. We went over there, and you know, we're dialed in and got to go to the good places and stuff like that, but it's just a shit show, and just straight, you know. So I mean, I think it was last or a couple of years ago, we had the Super Bowl, the Waste Management Open, all in the same weekend, and Scottsdale and that area was just insane.
Your marriage barely survived at that,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, she was with me. She got
okay,
with me.
Good.
She has fun. So.
Hey, the family that, yeah. Mine too. Mine, we party together, so that's how we stay together. But now, is the Waste Management Open, is that the one with the caddies race? Like,
yeah,
foot race?
Yeah, they race to the greens. I think they, they banned it this year, but you'll have guys, like, we were there and one guy just ran, took off his clothes and jumped in the water and swam across, got out and put his hands behind his back and waited to get
his ran just that's coming. So like waste management opens like a real life heavy goer.
It really is. I mean, people go there, the girls are all wearing absolutely nothing, the guys are all, 90% of them are walking around stumbling, don't even know where they're at, you know. It's crazy. And then they have concerts every night. Uh-huh. It's fun. We do it, you know, we do it once a year. Because my brother-in-law's or Potter putting it on and stuff like that. So it's fun. You know, when we go, my wife's always, we'll get a babysitter and try to do as much as we can together. She'll come and travel with me too. So we have fun together.
And that's essential, right? Because of all the traveling you do, I know you're fighting and training, but your sponsorships, I know you have a lot of obligations, stuff like that. I do the same for work. It's always good that when you have like a particular weekend or a trip that you can bring the missus on.
Oh yeah, you know? Absolutely. You know, we've been, what's great about, we've been fortunate enough to travel the world and fight and perform in front of, in different countries, different crowds, and it's an excuse for my friends and family to go to a place like Sweden where they normally wouldn't just say, all right, let's just go to Sweden and go to Stockholm. So that's what I love about it. I feel like it brings a lot of my friends and family together.
Yep.
So an excuse to go out there. And last time, you know, with Sweden, went out there, had friends and my wife come out, and then we went to Prague after and jumped around a little bit for a couple of days and went back home. See the kids, so it's definitely she hops along with me when we have fights and going out of the country, stuff like that. So it makes it fun.
Did you stop by Amsterdam while you're out there?
We did not.
That's right, because you have to behave yourself.
We went by Prague and that was fun, and I really liked it there. And then who knows what happens? There's different cards coming up. Whatever organization, like my last two fights were. We're overseas, we're in Germany and Brazil, so I don't mind doing those, and I'd like to do more in the future, so see the world, have fun, and perform.
That's what it's about, right?
Yeah.
So every stop we've had so far, we've asked us one question. You know, we've seen you fight in the octagon, we know, the work you've done, but it all starts somewhere, right? So what's the craziest, and you're a frat guy, right?
Like, I was a wrestling team, so pretty
right,
bad.
Pretty much same thing. What is the craziest Ryan Bader street fight story? You got to have one great one.
Yeah, well, it was actually, I was with the wrestling team. Everybody was pretty crazy in general. And this one night, we did not even begin to pick any kind of fight or whatever. It was late, and we were at a bar, and there was probably, I would say, 5 to 7 of us, and there were a lot of the smaller guys, like 125 pounders and stuff. This guy comes over a few times and just harassing one of the guys, and we're like, come on guys, we're just trying to eat, whatever. Mm-hmm. So it happens again, I'm like, all right. And so we pull the tables out and a bunch of us get out, and the guy has a pool stick and he's talking to me. He goes back to hit me with the pool stick. My friend jumps on him, and there's just chaos. There's probably 8 of them. And so we start fighting, me and my friend start fighting this big juice head guy. And so he has him a choke. I start kneeing him, boom, boom. He goes down, is knocked out. I'm fighting a couple other guys. I'm waiting to, just start getting hit again. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden this guy jumps on my back and is choking me. And it has it, like, knows what he's doing. I can tell he's making a choke. And he's like, wrestler, calm down. And I'm sitting here about to, like, get in a little fuzzy. I'm like, I'm gonna do a front flip through this glass coffee table to get him off. Like, I was about to. And I realized it was one of my buddies, kind of, friends, whatever, a bouncer. So I was like, all right, let me go. He let me go. And I look over. 8 of these dudes are unconscious on the ground in the bar. The little 125 pounders
just worked them,
knocked out these big 250 pound dudes. And so we jetted out of there, got out of there. Luckily didn't get in any kind of trouble, but that was the only time. It was like a movie when 8 guys, they were being total dicks. And
it was like a scene out of Roadhouse, right?
It was, and when I looked over, it was like a massacre just happened. It was 8 bodies laying on the ground. I was hoping everybody was all right and everything, but we got out of there and everything was fine. But I want to see that security tape sometime.
You're like, and then you're like, yes, ASU bitches. That's how we get down. So one other thing we've been asking too is, most of the time when you talk to the media, You know, it's a fight week, you're cutting weight, you got an important fight in front of you, and you sit and you answer the same 30 questions over and over and over. Or you're doing like the tag radio hits where you're one phone call after the next. In something like this where we come out to you, where we come into your element, where it's relaxed and we take the time to see what goes in to how you do things. What's the difference like that? I mean, do you see a big difference, and do you appreciate, or do you like the way we kind of do
this?
No,
I definitely like this way better than doing the whole sit down and take phone calls or have media come up to you. Number one, because I know you, like you, and we just sit here and talk. And I feel like the fighters can open up more.
Yeah.
You know, it's your kind of cookie cutter responses when you're sitting there on the platform and you have just people coming over. It's more of, especially media day, it's more of like, all right, let's get done with this so I can go back to my hotel room kind of deal, or cutting weight, you know. So, yeah, for the ability to do this is one of the better media plays, you know. So, you know, and we can, like I said, we can just open up, you know, and I've been just doing that more often, not really. It's not like I don't care, but it's just like, you know, it's just gonna say whatever I want.
Yep.
I don't feel like I have to be that mold anymore, really. Mm-hmm. So, and it's what it is, but I like the style for sure.
Yeah, and this is just kind of two buddies bullshitting, but with, you know, and with, you said, like, taking the interviews and just being loose. I mean, you've always been a real guy. Like, like there's never been any, like, I don't think there's been any pretension, or I don't think you've ever tried to fit their mold.
No,
a lot of guys do.
Yeah.
But I think now with things going the way you want them, and now you're in the driver's seat much more, I can't wait to see kind of what this year brings for you, man.
Thank you. Yeah, and it's just about kind of controlling your own destiny too, and not letting other people kind of dictate, you know, what you're doing. And yeah, we're in a sport, we're independent contractors, and yeah, a lot of times it's like, hey, you're fighting this guy, whatever. But it's nice to just kind of rely on yourself. So I've been trying to do that more.
And I think a lot of guys make the mistake of saying, like say, take a step up and take a short notice fight or help them out. I think people think that, like, that's giving them a salad, so, like, that's going to get them better in favor. That's never how it works.
No.
Like, I don't think, you know, people understand the UFC doesn't really like anybody.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, they're a business, you know? You know, if you're running a business, you have the bottom line, and you know, you're going to do whatever is best for your business right there, you know. And so I get that part of it, but yeah, I mean, coming into, you know, when we were younger, we heard about these like locker bonuses and stuff, where they would come and give you, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars and whatnot, and it was always dangling there for you, and take the short notice fights because, you know,
it helps
take care of you, and maybe you ain't being a better graces and whatnot, when that's the other flip of the coin, you know, there's guys that took a short notice fight, lost, and they're gone.
Ben Saunders.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, so it's you gotta look out for yourself, and it's not like you can't trust anybody, but, you know, it's gotta be selfish in this sport.
Yeah.
And you've seen a lot of these guys do it, when even they're getting backlash from the public and all that, and then boom, they either have a title shot or they got what they wanted,
yep,
you know, by sticking to their guns a little bit, you know. And so, we're trying to do that a little more.
Well, and then the last question I have for you, since we're talking, you just mentioned business. I heard that you guys are stepping things up around here. I heard you got a new coach.
Yeah, we got a new coach, Jair. He's Brazilian Coach of the Year last year, and he's doing a lot of drilling, which is great for me. You know, I'm learning new things just stepping up my game. You know, it's great to just learn from new people. He was in my corner last time in Brazil, and he's really respected, and just seeing him down there, he was like a rock star. You know, people yelling his name and stuff. So, I'm loving it so far. Just the drilling aspect of it alone.
Yeah.
I'm just getting a lot more technical. That's what I needed at my age and this experience level, you know.
Yeah, and that's one thing I've always noticed about you is the progression. Like, I've watched, you know, and we've talked about it plenty over the years, like, I've watched, you notice how your footwork changes, how your head movement changes, how these things kind of go, you're always in, like, the process of progress, right? And I think with this new Bellator, if that's the way it goes, the new situation, where it's a flat rate, then they're going to see the best Ryan Bader that there is, because you're not, like you said, you're not fighting to, like, oh man, I got half my paycheck on the line, not to be safe, but I gotta fight a certain way.
Yeah.
If you just got like, hey, look, the pay's taken care of, I'm getting paid for whatever happens, then I'm gonna go out there and guns blazing and show my best.
Exactly.
Is that how you feel?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, there's times, and I think all of us are guilty of it at some point, where if I'm a better wrestler than somebody and I know I can beat him by going out there and taking him down, you know, 10, 12 times a fight, and yeah, you're always trying to finish everybody out there, but when you're fighting top 10, top 5 guys, it's tough, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm gonna use that, you know. If he's a striker, say we're kind of equal strikers, but I have this wrestling card over him, I'm gonna use that to secure half my pay, you know. At the other side of the coin, if you're getting a flat fee, I can go out there and let loose and not have to worry about it as much. Yeah, I want to win, but it's not everything, because you know, if I'm not getting half my paycheck and then I have a loss on my record, then you get a few losses and then you're in jeopardy of losing your job.
Yep.
You know, and so I definitely like that flat fee kind of moving forward with that.
And then to wrap it up, you know, say if everything goes right and you sign a belt or a Bellator thing goes through, there's Phil Davis. He sent you a message saying he wants that fight. Why don't you go ahead and let Phil know what's up?
Well, I'm the last guy to beat him, you know, so that belt is basically mine. I just got to make it official. Let's go. No, I love Phil. He's done a great job over there, so I'd love to mix it up with him again.